Previously on the Board Boys podcast.
Hey, I'm a board boy, Cam. Cut me open, Doc. I gotta give my kidney to my long-lost brother.
Well, here's the thing about Munchkin, though, you guys.
Hey, I'm gonna need you to put the snacks down while we're recording.
Are you kidding me with those dice? Are you kidding me? Are you freaking... Oh, my...
Hooray, I win.
You know what? Screw this. Screw you all. I'm going home.
Yahtzee.
You like what kind of cheese?
Tonight on the Board Boys, Rajas of the Ganges and Meeple Circus.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to episode one, season three of the Board Boys podcast.
Actually, I think this is episode zero since we, well, I don't want to be the one to break the news, but we don't have a guest tonight.
Wah, wah, wah.
So, this is the inaugural episode of season three, but I don't know if we're going to call it episode one.
I'm going to call it episode one anyway. We're mixing things up a little bit, but it is spooky season.
Hey, what about episode 0.8?
It's really going to make things confusing when you don't understand what it's like to have to upload this stuff.
Frank gets it.
I get it now. I didn't used to get it, and I feel so much for Josh that I didn't feel before.
Welcome to episode one, season three of the Board Boys podcast. As Campbell said, we do not have a guest this evening. So
this is not the third season of our first episode.
So we're giving you... two games tonight that aren't quite on the BGG Top 100 list, but they're games that we both love, or we all love, that we thought it'd be fun to just do a quick two-for-one episode. So tonight we're playing Rajas of the Ganges, and we are playing Meeple Circus. But before we get to that, let's take it around the table. Fellas, what have you been playing lately?
Oh, man. Should I go first?
Please.
Yes, please.
Yeah. So this week I got to play the Reckoners, which, generally speaking, cooperative games are not the thing I like go crazy about. And I don't know a whole lot about the Reckoners other than that this dude Brandon Sanderson is apparently like a super good writer. But I had a blast playing the game, and I don't know if it was like the super amped up Kickstarter version, but the components were really nice. It's super, super simple.
That's a lot of supers.
Yeah, oh yeah. You could teach it to anybody in just a couple seconds, but the strategy is really fun. And I think one of the gripes I have about games like this a lot of the time are that they get kind of convoluted and take a long time to do stuff. This one went so smoothly. I had a blast playing that.
I can't stop right now thinking about how like Superman's name could have been Super Superman. Like, he's like not quite as, like, is he not as good of a superhero as he could be? Like, is... like, if he only did one super on his name, you know what I mean?
I don't follow.
Yeah, he could be Super Superman.
Oh, yeah,
but
sure.
But he's only Superman, so really, retrospectively, he's really not that good.
Well, maybe if he got under, like, a different type of sun, that
yeah,
would
he'd
make
be
him
like
more
extra
powerful.
Super,
yeah.
Or, like, in a planet that was
or
a little bit
went,
closer.
Or if he went back to his regular digs, because, like, those people at his original spot aren't, like, super tough, right?
No, I mean,
so he would just be here, man, if he went there.
Do you ever think if like Superman's like homeworld wasn't destroyed, if he would be like the nerd that like all the big guys at school
would pick on and make
fun of?
He would have been like a prep school rich kid. He would have been one of the guys that Ryan Atwood beat up in OC season one.
Well, he was
mean?
The son of the king of that world,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Oh,
so
he would be like
DJ Khaled's kid.
Yeah, that's.
I
think that equivalent holds
up. Is Superman Jor-El or is his dad Jor-El?
It's Jolnar, and they're Jolnar. A Twilight Imperium 4th edition
isn't
race.
Isn't that the name? Isn't that Kal-El?
Kal-El.
Superman's
Kal-El,
right? Kal-El. Jor-El? Jor-El's like DJ Khaled, like getting on Instagram and be like, yo, I just bought my son Clark Kent these diamond shoes because he needs those. You played yourself. I don't know this guy. I hate DJ Khaled, though.
I think that's what DJ Khaled says.
Hey,
so, yeah.
What else did you play?
Yeah, did you play more games?
Yeah,
or
I totally
what?
Did. I played Bunny Kingdom again this week, which I think is pretty fun. Richard Garfield. Jared, who has been on the podcast before, does not like that game, but I had a blast. Played Imperial 2030 again. Always like that. What else did I play this week? I think that's actually what I've played this week. Is that insane?
Two games? Bunny three, Kingdom three and games. Reckoners? What was the third?
Imperial 2030.
Oh, Imperial.
I feel like, oh, you know what? I played a few games of Yahtzee and Cribbage with my mom when I was visiting my folks the last couple days.
Dope.
And we actually got out this old Ravensburger game for kids called Rivers, Roads, and Rails, where you have to like align. It's kind of like Carcassonne, except for like from like 15 years before.
Okay.
And also for like little kids.
Sure.
I tried to make up some rules that made the game a little more competitive, but it was tricky.
Didn't work.
So, yeah.
Franklin, what'd you play?
So we haven't, it hasn't been that long actually since we recorded our Jamie Stegmaier episode that just went up.
Yeah, it was.
It was super recently, and right after that I went on vacation and I didn't end up playing any games.
You didn't play any games in Philly?
Zero games.
Wow.
Nikki brought, she got Love Letter and Citadels for her birthday, and she brought them camping, but we were just so busy like
doing camping stuff.
Yeah, hanging out with people. Sure. And
sometimes
and
you gotta like chop a bunch of wood so you can make a good fire.
Yeah, that was one of the things we did. I mean, it was like 60 degrees at the height of the sun when I was there, and it was like raining. On that note though, we were in this place called Knobels in Catawissa, Pennsylvania.
Okay.
And it's like this super cool, we were at this campground called Lake Glory Campground, and like right up the road, like 2 miles, there's a like a theme park. Like there's like roller coasters and like then they decorate it all like spooky for Halloween because it's Halloween season. And that was super cool. Like I went on some rides, and like they've got like, it's incredibly affordable like compared to a lot of theme park places. But like people were out there with their dogs, and like it was in the mountains. Like the whole place was surrounded by mountains.
It was just majestic.
It was like this super cool place that I went to. But no, I didn't play any board games.
That's okay.
Really
quick. You went to a theme park.
Yeah.
Really quick. I did download the app for Onitama this week.
Oh.
I don't know if you guys have played that one.
Well, I have not.
But it's this really simple little abstract game where you have to, it's kind of like sort of chessy, where you have to take like the main piece of the other player. But you have a deck of cards and you deal 5 of them out.
Yep.
And every turn you use one of the 2 cards you had last turn. And that card you pass when you use it, it's your movement card, to the player who goes next, and they don't use it that turn. They use one of the 2 cards they have, and then they pass back to you one of those 2.
Mm-hmm.
And it's really simple. Just get your main guy to the other end of the board in the main spot. Or take the main guy with one of your 5 guys.
That reminds me of something else that has happened this week, and that's Terraforming Mars came out on Steam.
It did.
And I'm seeing so many people on Twitter posting about it, and I've just played Terraforming Mars the 2 times back when we played it on the podcast.
Yep.
And man, it makes me really want to play Terraforming Mars again. And it looks like a really streamlined, like Steam version of the game.
Yeah, that looks awesome.
Anyone else, if you guys have seen it in person or...
I have not.
I'll have to get that soon, but yeah, I didn't even really know that.
Yeah, it's out on Steam now, and it's crazy the stuff that is going on with like digital versions of board games these days. I think it's super cool.
Heck yeah. You guys want to know what I played?
100%.
Hey Josh, what'd you play?
Hey guys, I played a couple things since we did our Jamie Stegmaier episode.
My dad's calling us. I want to make sure it's not like an emergency or something. Hey Dad, how you doing? Oh yeah, I'm actually recording the podcast right now, and I was just gonna bring that up to these guys, it's a surprise, so I don't want to I don't want to ruin it by saying it, but yeah, we're gonna probably be done a little later. Is it cool if I give you a call tomorrow morning to chat about that?
Are you still?
Oh,
I might use this.
What's that? I haven't been there. Sorry about that.
That's
okay.
I just
wanted to make sure it wasn't something serious.
I hear you. Well, now you got me curious, Campbell. What's the big news that your dad called to tell you about?
Oh, well, no, he was asking about... I sent my dad a picture, and my mom, of something that I saw today when I was out driving around rural Iowa.
Oh, this thing. Okay.
And I was blown away. Never seen this before. And so what do you think, you guys, that I saw out driving around rural Iowa?
What were the descriptors again?
Okay, I was saying that I've never seen it before. I don't think I'll ever see it again. And I think most places in the U.S. you could probably see this. But it's like super, super, super rare, and it makes you feel really warm inside.
I'm going to guess, because we live in the state of Iowa, you saw two cows getting all jiggy with it.
My guess was something pretty similar, except for like the aftermath. My assumption is that you saw a deer with a doctor's coat on delivering another deer having its babies.
Oh, Dr. Deer. No, Dr. I see Dr. Deer pretty often. But no, I saw, are you guys ready for it?
Go ahead.
A bald eagle.
Oh, that's
nice.
It?
Nice. No, that was
that's
actually
it.
No, yeah. that was my original. They're endangered.
But they're also all over the south side of Des Moines.
I've never seen
are
a bald
kidding?
Eagle.
Yeah, if you just go drive across the bridge over by Principal Park, there's like two or three that fly
this
around.
This thing
over
was
there.
Majestic. It was huge, and it was a big old white head and white tail, and it was flying around.
Hold on. You never think that for the rest of your life you'll see a bald eagle
out flying around? No, man.
Dude, he's like, you know, in his mid-30s, okay, and he's never seen one before.
Also, they're endangered, and most of them went into hiding after,
you know,
September 2001.
The thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Well.
So anyway.
It's hard to top that.
So, Josh, what'd you play
this
week?
Dude, it cried a little tear, and I swear, when the first time it took off, it actually lit up a couple Roman candles and were shooting them either direction when it was...
in its talents, yeah.
Yeah.
I can't top that, but I can tell you guys what I played recently.
Josh, what do you see right now?
What
do you see right now?
I see your hand over your heart.
My hand is on my heart.
Yep. Yep.
Oh,
God
say
bless America.
Can you see?
So this week, I played a couple things. Since the last time we did a full episode, I played some additional games of Lords of Waterdeep. However, this time I played with the Skullport expansion. I was gushing over Lords of Waterdeep the first time we played it for the podcast, and I must say that with the Skullport expansion, it is a must-own for me. The mechanisms that it adds, I think, are very cool. Frank, one of the things that you will appreciate just as like a high level, there's a couple different expansion game options that you can play, and we played one that added corruption. So in addition to all of the spots on the board, there were these super powerful spots that you could go to on a separate board that were like, get one of every unit type and take a corruption, or get four units and you get to pick what they are and take a corruption. But then on the left, there's another board that goes from -1 all the way up to -9. And there's three corruption skulls on each of those spaces. And whenever you do something that takes corruption at the end of the game, whichever space is the farthest along space that is completely removed, every skull that you have is worth negative that many points on your score. So it can help you ramp up early on and try and complete some stuff, or it's like always there if you need it. But if you get stuck and you have too many, we had like the game that we played, one of the guys had like -40 points. But then there's also these cool new lords that feed off of the corruption. And instead of getting, I think you get like 4 points for every corruption.
That's brilliant.
Yeah, so it's really cool. It makes it a lot easier to get stuff if you're in a pinch. So I played that. Had a really good time there. I did play Meeple Circus, which we're gonna play a little bit later. So I'm not gonna talk too much about that.
I've only played it once, but it's fun.
It is. I'm not very good at it, but I'm really excited to play it again tonight. And then the last thing I played on Wednesday is I got in a game of Western Legends. Finally, Campbell's favorite European worker
sandbox
placement sandbox game.
Hey, you know what? If we went back and counted all the times I said something dumb, we'd have a lot of time. So let's not dwell on this one.
But Western Legends was really fun. It's a sandbox game. You can do whatever you want to an extent. You can kind of go wherever. There's a couple different tracks
can you go
on
the board?
You cannot go off the board. Okay. That's where I said to a certain extent.
Well, I was just wondering if that was the extent.
That is the extent, yes. But yeah, there's a couple different tracks. There's a wanted track and a martial track where you can be like a good guy or a bad guy. You can bounce back and forth between the two.
An anti-hero.
Yeah.
So chaotic neutral.
Yeah, essentially, yes.
Or maybe true neutral.
But you can get points, like you can get points by, there's like a Texas Hold'em mechanic that's built in where you actually draw cards from a deck, and you can get points by just playing poker all game, or you can go and you can try and fight bandits, or you can become a bandit and rob banks, and like there's really so many different ways to get points, and it was just a lot of fun.
Can you be famous cowboys of the West?
That's actually your character. So in the game,
I figured that was the case. That's
yes,
why I wanted.
So
to
in the game, every character is every player is dealt two heroes from the olden days. And then you get to pick one. And then each of those characters has a special ability, but the special ability does not unlock until you get 5 legendary points.
I'm going to ask you, can you be Wyatt Earp?
Yes.
Can you be Doc Holliday?
Yes.
Can you be... I got this. Can you be Yosemite Sam?
No.
Can you be Charlie Sheen?
No.
Can you be Emilio Estevez?
No.
Can you be Billy the Kid?
Yes.
That's Emilio Estevez.
Can you be Lou Diamond Phillips?
No.
Can you be John Wayne?
No.
How about Rooster Cogburn?
Nope. I don't think so.
That was John Wayne's character in True Grit.
Yeah, no.
Can you be...
The Man from Snowy River?
Yes.
The first one or the second one? Be specific.
Oh, there's two?
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
And the answer is no, either way.
What about Lucky Luke?
No.
What about Red Dead Redemption?
No, but I'm so excited for that. There's a lot of really cool characters, and they all have really, really cool abilities.
What about Paul Bunyan? Can you be him?
You cannot be Paul Bunyan.
Daniel Boone?
Nope.
Davy Crockett.
Who are you?
I played as, I'm going to blank on his first name, but his last name was Bass. He was the first...
Big Mouth Billy Bass.
he was the first African-American U.S. Marshal that was awarded or like responsible for over 3,000 arrests, including like...
Oh, that guy's so cool.
Including his own brother.
That guy's like the coolest dude.
And he's considered to be like one of the greatest U.S. Marshals.
Bass is his first name.
Was it?
Bass Reeves.
Bass Reeves. Yeah, I played as Bass Reeves. He was dope. His ability was really cool. But it's got a really cool like poker system. The battle mechanic's super, super clever, very straightforward. It's just high card wins, but the cards have effects on them also. I'm excited for us to play it. I think you guys are really going to like it.
Cool.
We're going to keep this moving because we got two games to talk about this evening. The first game, Rajas of the Ganges, came out, I feel like it came out last year, didn't it?
I'm pretty sure it came out last year. So Josh and I each picked a game for tonight, like ones that we could get done pretty quickly. Rajas is one that I picked, and Meeple Circus is the one Josh picked.
Yep.
But
We're going to talk about both, and then we're going to play both, and then we're going to come back and we're going to critique both.
Yeah.
Rajas of the Ganges came out in 2017. Its current score is 7.7. We know it's not on the top 100, but would you guys like to give a guess at where it's currently at? It is in the top 300. I will say that.
My guess is it has a pretty good score, but maybe like 140.
Okay. Franklin?
My original guess was 120, so I'm going to go with it.
You guys are both wrong. It's 248. If we're looking at strategy, you're a little closer. It's 143. 2 to 4 players, best with 4. 45 minutes to 75-minute playtime. We'll see if that holds up. 12 plus and a weight of 2.88 out of 5.
And you don't need to listen to the cast because there's 142 better strategy games you can go play. So,
Campbell, why don't you quickly explain what people do in Rajas of the Ganges?
Rajas of the Ganges is the way you play the game is through worker placement. Nothing super new there. But the thing that's really cool about it is you are collecting dice. Dice are kind of your resource to build a little tableau in front of you that gives you one type of points, which is currency, and another type of points, which is fame. And the winner is the player who the currency and the fame are both on a track around the board. And the first player to intercept or like overcross their currency and their fame wins. So
it's a race,
which is a cool thing.
That's pretty neat.
Yeah.
Well, it's a balancing act too.
Yep.
Yeah.
Speaking of balancing acts,
Cirque du Soleil.
That would have been a perfect transition if you were done, but I don't think you're done talking about the game
yet.
We'll
talk about it a little bit more, but basically you use 4 different colored dice to take all the actions, and then you have workers to like choose where you're going.
Yep.
And it's very fun, very kind of noodly, but unlike the point salads that I'm normally into with like these dice manipulation games, this one is very straightforward. There's only two types of ways to get points, and it's one type of point versus the other type of point. So
say that sounds really balanced, Frank.
No. Speaking of balancing acts.
Speaking of acts where you could balance something.
The second game we're playing is on the exact opposite end of that spectrum.
Which is why I chose Rajas after you said
Meeple
Circus.
We are playing Meeple Circus, which is a dexterity game. Meeple Circus currently has a rank of 7.2 out of 10. Would anyone like to guess where that's at? I will say it's in the top 1,000.
I'm going to say it's number 420.
Oh.
I'm going to say it's number 609.
Yeah, it is number 888. However, sweet. If you're looking at just the party category, it drops to 46.
Well, yeah, because it's fun.
And if you're looking at a family category, it's 186. The game came out earlier or late 2017. 2 to 5 players. It's best with 4 to 5. 45 minutes, 8+, and a weight of 1.34 out of 5. Meeple Circus, like I said, is a dexterity game. Essentially, every round, characters will be adding acrobats and or animals to their available pool of units to place. And then when we go to the second phase where we actually perform our acts, you have a limited amount of time. There's a song that plays on Matago's website that just like ups the anticipation and the nervousness, if you will, of the game. And then you score points based off of a couple different things. There are public objective cards that you work towards that can vary every turn. There are points that you get for having acrobats in certain positions. And then over the course of the game, you get guest stars, which are like the strong man and the Tarzan, and they do extra things that give you extra points. And then at the very end, there's like a huge final performance phase where it goes one player at a time. And it's just, it's very, very, very fun. So we're going to play both of those. Campbell, Frank, anything you guys would like to add about either of the games or anything about life in general before we get going here?
Nah, let's do it.
Let's roll, baby. Time we just had playing Rogers of the Ganges on the Meeple Circus.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are back from playing Rajas of the Ganges and Meeple Circus. Let's take it around the table, and I'm not going to say the game. I just want you guys to tell me what you're currently feeling right now after playing two games that are literally on complete opposite ends of the spectrum. Frank?
Literally.
Well, they're both placement games.
Yeah. Technically, you got me there.
Should we do one game at a time, actually?
Yeah, let's start with Rogers of the Ganges. Thoughts on Rogers of the Ganges, Frank?
Not thrilled.
I guarantee I know why. We'll talk about that in a second. Campbell?
Oh, I love Rogers. It's one of my favorite games.
I bet our listeners know why already. We don't even have to tell them. You guys can just guess.
Yeah, they'll just figure it out. It's fine. Like I said, when I walked in and I saw it sit on the table, I was not excited, nor was I disappointed.
He was a little disappointed. His shoulders dropped. Like his face was like.
Well, yeah. In my defense, I didn't know that Josh had played that before. I would have picked a different game if I'd known.
And
I think Josh was hoping to play something new.
It was fine for like Rogers of the Ganges. For what it is, I enjoy it. I like the race mechanic aspect of it or mechanism for it. So yeah, it's right. It's a game for me that if someone ever said, "Hey, let's play Rogers of the Ganges," I wouldn't like fight it to say like, "Let's play anything else." But I also would not probably recommend it if it would not be my pick if somebody said, "Hey, let's play a game." But so I'm getting too into it. Let's go.
Just go down a little tangent real quick. Like, I like that you corrected yourself when you said that it has a racing mechanic, and then you said, "No, it's a mechanism." But I guarantee you that there's a lot of racing mechanics out there, and they're called pit crews, right?
That's true.
Yeah,
they're actually in that game, Downforce, I think.
Oh yeah, Downforce.
I love when we can make board game jokes about.
Is Downfall
the
one where you
jokes.
Bet on the car that's going to win?
I don't know. I've never played it before.
There's that one. I played it with Rob not too long ago. That game is really. There's this. I think it is Downforce. It's not like. So most car racing games I've played, just to go on a quick tangent, I just don't like them.
Yeah.
Like
sure.
They're boring. But there's this one and it's really simple and you just. You have control of a car and you try to, you know, get it.
Sounds like Downforce.
Or actually, no, you don't have control of a car. You play cards and you move
that are colors
the cars
of a certain color.
Yeah, you move.
That's Downforce.
Yeah, that's how many you move.
Yeah, that's
but
Downforce.
You bet on what cars are going to win.
Yep. That sounds like Downforce.
And you also own a couple of the cars and then you get points at the end of the game.
Frank,
for,
does that sound like Downforce to you?
I think from what I've heard about Downforce, this sounds like that's the game you're describing.
Okay, well, are you talking about Downforce?
I think I'm talking about Downforce.
So why are we talking about Downforce when the games we played are Rogers of the Young? Oh, well, I'm just bringing us back in. Cool. I completely agree with what you were saying. I haven't played Downforce before.
I think Downforce is fun.
I will say when
I'm just saying there's a lot of racing mechanics.
Well, oh, sure. There are also racist mechanics in board games. Sup, Puerto Rico. We'll talk about that.
And
never.
Kemet.
And Kemet. What did you guys think? The good? Let's shotgun through this because we got two games to talk about
tonight. Do we want to do the initial thoughts on Meeple Circus too?
No, let's go all the way through Rogers of the Ganges. We're giving everybody a peek behind the curtain for
okay, but
what
Frank,
we normally decide.
It so that we did it the way I said though.
Campbell, what do you like about this game?
Rogers of the Ganges? I like that it's a crunchy little noodly little Euro that plays in like an hour.
Yes.
And I think it's so neat that you have two types of points and that the winner is the one who crisscrosses them the fastest.
Yes.
Or best.
I agree that it's neat.
You do?
I do think, like, that was the first thing I thought about this game. I thought, oh, it's really cool that you've got to have, like, a balance here in order to be successful. You can't put everything into one thing.
Yeah, and you really can't. But the other thing that's really cool is I like the way the game is played. I like using workers to get dice and then using the dice as resources to do the things that you do. And I don't know if Frank feels this way, but even though you're collecting colored cubes once again, those cubes have a purpose and the things you do with them thematically, I think, work.
You're talking about the dice.
Yeah, so you use the dice as a resource, but
calling them cubes won't make Frank like
well,
this
no,
game
they
anymore.
Don't. Frank doesn't, but what I'm saying is,
like the purple dye doesn't mean like it doesn't represent something
right,
but I think that there's enough theme in the game where you don't think like what am I collecting these purple dice for.
Yeah,
those are just extra resources you have in order to build a little path and to scoot up a little river.
Yep,
which I think is neat.
Yeah. Anything else that you like about this game?
I like everything about this game. Rajas of the Ganges is one of my favorite games, and but some of the things I think are really cool about it are I always think dice manipulation is fun.
Yep.
And I think there were a couple turns where Frank just got like the absolute worst rolls he could have gotten. There was a turn where I got like the exact numbers I didn't want also. But there's usually in the game enough avenues to utilize the crummy dice you have to get different or more dice or to go about your business in a way where you're a little set back, but not a ton. And so that's why I like games like this, why I also praise Castles of Burgundy for that. You know, there's always something you can do with a dice, even if it's not optimal. Unlike other games that utilize dice where either you get big numbers or you're screwed. So.
And I want to agree with that in theory. Like when I jump into my pros here, in theory, that's like, I really like the idea that it's that there's so many ways to change which dice you have or manipulate which dice you have. I mean, on top of that, there are some other things I liked, like I said, the way that you have to balance the two separate tracks in order to win the game. I thought the game was very pretty. I liked the transparent, colorful dice. I thought the artwork on your individual boards was really cool. A lot of what I like about Euros is present in this game as far as mechanics, building buildings. I don't know. It had some really good features. The idea of being able to flip your die over. and like change the amounts that are on them. Like I said, it's really good in theory. In practice, it is one of my cons, but the idea is there and it's really cool.
Yeah. I mean, while we didn't use them a ton, I really like that this game has a catch-up mechanic built into it with the different tokens that you can get for your tableau board that you need to create. I do like the variety that the tableau board can provide. And while I don't necessarily always like the randomness, I do like the different tiles that can come up at different times that you're playing along. And you're like, oh, I think I know what I'm going to do. And then a tile comes up and you're like, oh, unless I can try and get that real quick, cause I'd much rather have that. So I like that aspect of it. And then, yeah, like I said, I think the race part of this is cool. I went more heavy on the money track this game. Normally I do the fame track. And I mean, I still lost. I think there's a lot of different ways to play this game. We didn't do too heavy on the river, which I thought was interesting. But yeah, I mean, this game has got a lot of stuff going for it. Like I said, if anyone ever says, hey, Josh, let's play Rajas of the Ganges, I won't fight them. But if they were to ever say, hey, Josh, what game would you like to pick? This is just probably one that I wouldn't throw out there. Unless I know that I'm playing with a specific group of people, which that's a whole another thing. Let's talk cons. Campbell,
I got a big one.
I'm going to start with you. What do you got?
So like I said, I love this game, but the only issue I see in the game that isn't player caused, right? Because you can have a bad game because you play for the first time and you don't really know what you're doing. You can have a bad game just because you make some decisions that aren't great. You could even get set back because you might be playing with two or three other people who constantly do the stuff you want to do. And that doesn't necessarily make a game bad as far as I'm concerned in any of those situations. It's just that was a tough time. Tonight, Frank got some roles that were really, really unhelpful for him. And he was in a position that he didn't have enough resources to not spend a few turns building back up, which usually you can kind of circumvent during the game via chain reactions. I just think there should be a mechanism in there that allows you to spend one of your dice to gain what they call karma, the 100% resource
agree.
In the game that lets you flip your dice, kind of the way you spend a dice in Castles of Burgundy for extra workers. Now, there's a spot on the board that lets you gain karma,
but
you have to have a dice with a 3 on it, and then you get 2 karma and a dice. I think that you should be able to, in the game, spend a dice to gain 1 or 2 karma. Maybe you use a 1 to 3 to gain 1 karma, or you use a 4 to 6 to gain 2 karma.
Yeah, the fact that there is like basically the one way to get karma really, really bummed me out, because I just wasn't rolling the right rolls, and that's the big con to any game with dice rolls to me, is like I just wasn't getting the rolls that I needed.
And this game has so many things you can do with dice that don't come up the numbers you want, but there was just one turn where Frank got a couple dice and what he rolled made him so situationally screwed that
it bummed me out for the rest of the game.
It took him a couple turns to bounce back from it. But if you had a mechanism where you get karma just from spending any dice, the way you can get workers, which let you manipulate your dice in Castles of Burgundy, just you're only spending one action to bounce back instead of 2 or maybe 3. And each action counts a lot near the end of the game.
For sure. And yeah, I mean, that takes care of most of my cons for the game. I was really frustrated. I mean, in a lot of Euro games like this, and I've mentioned it before, especially when you haven't played them before, it's hard to ever feel like you're being resourceful enough and being efficient enough to be competitive in the game. But when you add the additional negative of the possibility that maybe all of your dice throws are going to suck so much,
yeah,
that there's nothing you can do to be competitive besides, sure, just throw the dice away one way or another.
Sure.
Is really frustrating. I don't want to go on at length,
yeah,
about how much a dice roll.
And this is the thing too, like I got a couple rolls that may have looked good to, you know, people who weren't thinking about doing the things, you know, like they didn't know what I was thinking I wanted to do. I mean, there were a situation where I got like a 2, 3, 5 and I wanted a 1, 4, 6, right? Or like any of those numbers. But the thing about this game is it's kind of one of those games that you learn the first time you play and then you get really good at the second time you play. being in a situation where you get dice rolls that absolutely don't work with what you're trying to do, and you also don't know how to manipulate the game in order to get the things you want, that can be a kind of a, I think, a put off the first time you play.
Yeah, and like any other Euro game that we've done, I feel like I've said this a million times on this podcast, I'll play this game again and hopefully like it better the next time. It left a bad taste in my mouth this time.
Sure.
Well, you shouldn't have drank from the river, man. That's a dirty river.
It's
one of the dirtiest.
I've got two things, and they're not, I mean, one of them, no, anyway, I have two things. One, I think to your point, for a new player, there's a lot going on this board, so it's really just difficult to figure out what a good first move is to make.
As a person who's played plenty of, sorry to interrupt, but as a person that's played like plenty of Euro games before, I didn't think that the board was hard to follow, or like that the choices were difficult choices to make.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there were a few things that I was like, explain to me how this works again. But like, it's a pretty straightforward Euro as far as like your worker placement, the options that you can take. It's pretty straightforward. So, I mean, that wasn't a huge issue for me.
Yeah. But I just remember on my first, I played this game 3 times now. And on the first time I played this game, I remember sitting there and just going like, what is someone supposed to do on their first move? And you eventually figure it out. So that's not a huge con for me.
Can I just jump in when we're talking about like this type of, a lot of times games where you draft or manipulate dice, you have to like noodle those things into what you want them to be. And I feel like this one, if this is the first time you play a game like this, it's on the more confusing end of what do I do. But if you have played games that are similar to this before, this is on the less obtuse end. Like the first time I played Voyages of Marco Polo, that game like rashed me like hard. But this is closer to the, I would say again, I've mentioned it a bunch of times today, Castles of Burgundy. There's really only a few actions you can take. It's just what you make of them. And the nice thing about Burgundy, too, for new players is pretty much everything you do gives you points.
I liked Castles of Burgundy pretty well the one time that I played it. I mean, like, I looked at this board, and I went, second? And I was like, okay, I mean, like, here's buildings I can build. I know what the benefits of those buildings are. Which one do I want to build? Okay, so I want to, the first move I want to take is turning in one of my dice to roll two of a different color so that I can get one of these buildings. So, like, it wasn't tough for me to make a decision of, like, what my first couple moves were going to be right off the bat.
Sure. The second knock that I have on this game is fairly common. There's, like, one controversial element of this game, which I know we don't ever really bring up. But I'm a little disappointed in the goddess approach for this game. I'm not super religious, but it's always a bummer when either a publisher changes something to make the game look a little bit more appealing, or there's just like an art choice. A la Rising Sun had the whole thing with the deity that they added as a Kickstarter, and that thing never existed. It was like a Wikipedia thing. In the game, the god that they call out is very misprojected. The goddess Kali is like not super like violent as a person, but she's the goddess of, I think, slaughter, and so like she's holding severed heads and has knives in all of her hands, and she's not really big on meditation. And in this game, the goddess that's holding your dice looks like this like super tranquil being, which is just, it's just not religiously accurate at all. And I don't necessarily think that's a knock on the designer, because I know publishers change things all the time for one reason or another. I'm just very disappointed that they made that decision.
Who else is going to hold 8 dice?
Yeah, you understand why they did that, right?
I do, but I also know that there are other goddesses.
I understand.
There are other goddesses in the Hindu religion that have multiple arms that aren't always depicted as standing over a dead god or goddess with severed hands in their heads and knives. So there were other options. And I know they call out in the book, like, hey, this is who this goddess is, and this is her whole thing. It's just a bummer that that didn't get pulled all the way through, or they just went with another goddess that better fit what they were trying to show, because there are options. And that's just a bummer.
So are you saying let me just ask what you're...
Go ahead.
Are you saying you would rather that this game still utilize Kali, but like the board depicts like that dude from Temple of Doom pulling a still beating heart out of a guy's chest and lowering him into a furnace in a cage? Or are you saying you wish they'd used a different like Hindu god to represent?
Are you sure that it is Kali? Because
yes, it calls it out in the rule book.
Does it? Because yeah. I was just looking at it on Google and I was like, maybe it's Vishnu. I mean, it's mm-hmm. pretty much the same. I mean, like visage wise, like having the number
that's
of
Kali.
Arms
that's the Temple of Doom though, right? Kali?
That's Kali Ma.
Oh, okay.
Where they pull the heart out of the guy's
chest. Is that a different
chest? I don't know. Yes. That's Indiana Jones. So I don't know.
Yeah, but that's right in there. Indian is right in the name Indiana.
To your question, I would have more preferred if they wanted to keep it in this realm that they went with a goddess that better fits what they were depicting, which
like
again,
Vishnu.
There were options. They did not have to say, we are depicting the goddess Kali, who is the goddess of slaughter. And oh, by the way, she's normally like depicted very differently. It's just, it's like I said, I feel like it's lazy. I feel like it was kind of a bummer. I still enjoy the game and the mechanisms of the game. And this isn't the only game that is guilty of this. Again, Rising Sun is one of my favorite games and they are a prime offender of this. It's just it's a bummer when you see it happen.
I mean, don't you think that pretty much any game that uses history misrepresents certain aspects of that history in one way or another? Like, I know there was some controversy over this game, but like, and I don't pretend to know a whole lot about the Hindu religion, but mm-hmm. like, don't you think that like pretty much every game you play that's based on actual history probably gets something wrong some way or another?
Let me ask you, I don't disagree with the point that you're making, but I think there's a much bigger deal between maybe changing one small fact about a war versus completely like misrepresenting one of the main goddesses of the Hindu religion.
I'm just going to, whenever I play this game, I'm going to house rule it and say
it's somebody else.
That's Vishnu.
Well, yeah. Well, here's the thing. I'm just going to house rule it and say that all the dice are severed heads and that's how you're building your
whole
area.
Sure.
There you go.
And then we solve the problem with a house rule. Like I said, I just go back to, I wish the publisher or I choose to believe that this was not the designer's decision and it was probably something from the publisher's standpoint, but it just came off as either lazy or we are going to beautify, if that's even a word, the packaging to make this game look a little bit more appealing.
Yeah, to me it's a relative non-issue. I think to you it is as well. I think that you just want to bring it up, but that you're not like actually having a beef with it.
If that kind of thing would offend you, don't buy this game.
I mean, yeah. If that kind of stuff does offend you, then
or Puerto
Rico,
don't buy that. This kind of things
offend you. There are games, and I don't think it's laughable. I mean, there are things that people get offended by, and I think that that's okay. And I think that as long as people are willing to voice their concerns that they have about this, whether or not a publisher is going to accept it or acknowledge it is one thing. But as long as they are challenged,
it's important
we can
always
discussion. Hold the community to a higher standard so that these kinds of things happen less and less. So while some people may not really care and have no problem with Puerto Rico and have no problem with games like this, there are people that do care. And for
their sake, why not make it a little bit more accurate? Because it's not going to matter to Cam at the end of the day if it's more accurate or not, but it is going to matter to some people.
Exactly.
Right, that's true. And I guess to me, I don't mean to be insensitive. I just don't find inaccuracies offensive. And whether or not I care really strongly about something or not, mm-hmm. if I'm playing a game and I find it inaccurate, like that doesn't bother me.
Yeah, I mean, there are tons of people that say it's a game.
Yeah.
Which again, I get that. Like,
so I don't mean to belittle anybody's opinions or say that it should be a non-issue for everybody. Mm-hmm. I'm just saying that like that kind of thing doesn't bother me, so I'm probably not the right person to comment on it.
Sure.
Let's keep things moving and move on to Meeple Circus.
Let's keep it moving on. Before we do that, let's just do a quick who we think this game is for. I will start. I think if you like light Euro games, I don't think this game is super heavy. I feel like if you like light Euro games that play in an hour, work like a light worker Euro placement game, I would say, if I were to make a recommendation and you like Euro games or worker placement games that play less than an hour, buy Lords of Waterdeep instead. I think it's a better game for a similar vein. But this game is good. I mean, if you like that and you don't have any in your collection, and you like games that have a beautiful table presence, definitely pick it up.
I agree. I say buy Lords of Waterdeep because there's dice in this game.
I would say buy Lords of Waterdeep if you like, again, lighter Euros. But I would say that as far as like strategic Euros, like deeper Euros, I would say this is about as deep as you can get in a Euro that plays in an hour.
It's still being an hour.
Like
yeah.
this one is definitely crunchier than Lords of Waterdeep. Yeah, that's my opinion anyway. But it's neither of them are that crunchy.
If you've listened to this podcast and you like games that Cam likes, pick up Rise of the Gods.
This is like one of my probably top 10.
Yeah. So let's move on. We played another game tonight that was on the opposite end of the spectrum. As Campbell said, it still technically has worker placement, so they're aligned.
It has meeple placement.
They're aligned there. But other than that, this game is completely different. This is a dexterity game where, as we said, over the course of the game, you are getting different performers, and you know those are acrobats and animals and special guests and all of these things that you're adding to your... you're adding to your rehearsal squad, and then you're building them up over the course of a couple rounds, and you're scoring points along the way. But this is just I'm gonna just start right away and say this is a super fun dexterity game through and through. But I do want to throw it to the two of you also. What are your immediate reactions with Meeple Circus?
Game is pretty fun. I think a lot about like if we finished up a game night and or like an episode of a podcast and. A lot of times it's like, hey, does anyone want to play another game? And I'm like, yeah, I want to go home and go to bed. If someone said, you want to rock out a game of Meeple Circus, I'd be like, that game's pretty fun. I'd play
definitely.
A game of that.
Campbell?
Initial reaction, I've played this game twice now, and I had a blast both times.
Yeah.
It's super just simple, quick and easy, and a lot of fun.
Yeah, I completely agree with everything that you guys said. The good... I love the variety. Like I've played this game probably 5 or 6 times in the last week, and there's 18 cards that 18 white tiles that will always come out, and those are considered more your basic tiles. They have two things on them in different combinations, so like
two components.
Yeah,
so
like an acrobat. Like an acrobat and
things you stack,
and like a barrel or an elephant and a bar or something like that. And then
circus stuff.
And then there are, I'll say for lack of a better term, more advanced cards that you get. And there's always a choice. You deal one more than the number of players, but those give you three components, and those are. You can get an elephant and a red acrobat and a balloon or something along those lines. So I love that those come out at different times. I love that there's more of the advanced cards than number of players. So there's always a variety and you always have a choice. What about you guys? What do you guys think?
I thought this game was really original. I thought that... Man, I mean, we're just throwing out pros right now. Is what we're trying to do.
Yeah, I got a couple, but I don't want to hog the mic.
So. Sure. I thought that the use of music was fun. The designs of the little original what do you call them? But like
the meeples,
the bonus.
Oh, the bonus cards. Yeah, we'll talk.
Whatever.
We can talk about that.
The little guys that you can add.
Yeah, the guest stars.
The guest stars. They were really really fun. I like that this game was just a quick, lighthearted game. I mean, that's my pros. That's all my pros.
I want to expand on two things you said real quick, just to give everybody some context. So this game is by Matigo, which I also love because Matigo also does awesome. Like dudes on a map games with Kemet and with is it Cyclades? That's the one that Rob always talks about. Cam, is that right? Could take it.
Yes.
Yes. Okay. So they have awesome area control games, but then on the flip side, they have awesome family games, which I think is just great. But two things: when you buy this game, you can either download an app or you can go to Matigo's website, and there is music that you have to listen to as you're building your. Or you're doing your circus routine, that's the timer. You don't have an unlimited amount of time. You have a little over 2 minutes. And I think that sensory component to it is huge because as the song goes on, it starts to play faster and faster, and there are cymbal crashes that start happening to let you know you're running out of time.
And I like how that plays into those, like the bonus cards that you can choose between in that last round.
Yeah.
I thought that was really cool.
Yeah, and so it just like it keeps building and building. In the first two rounds, everyone's working at the exact same time, and we're building at the exact same time, and there's bonuses for being the first one to finish your routine. The last phase, I think, is my most enjoyable part of this game. And what happens is everyone will have all of their meeples. Everyone instead of drafting a second advance card, the advance card that they draw is something specific that they have to do during their final construction to score bonus points. And it's hilarious things. It's like add an adjective before every component that you place. Every time that you place an acrobat, you know, delve into their personal life a little bit. But then there's some that up the difficulty where it's, you know, place your whole routine, but with your non-dominant hand, or cover one of your eyes. And if you can do those things, you score extra points. But I love that at the very end, you go one at a time. So you get everyone focused on you. You get that music that's just for you. And I love it. I love like how it doesn't give me anxiety, but it's just like, oh my God, I gotta go.
And this is a party game for the most part, but like I like that you're playing with your own pieces on your own board, and that I generally like that in games when you've got your own board
doing your own thing.
And you're doing your own thing is a thing that I enjoy in games. So I like that in this as well.
Campbell?
So here's some pros these guys haven't mentioned yet. It is a party game, and it is silly, and it's like a dexterity game. That's kind of how you build your little circus. But strategically and thematically, this game has sharper teeth than you would think. There are scoring objectives during the game that you can utilize to try to make a big score.
Yeah.
And the pieces you draft play into that. And you have to, since you're drafting components, you actually, if you're doing well, you're going to get less sought after components. So you have to figure out how to make those be worth as many points as the people behind you. But also thematically, once you're done building your little circus, it looks like a circus. Everything's stacked on top of each other, and you can just kind of imagine what's going on.
Yeah, well,
it's true. It's kind of cool.
We'll be sure to post up some photos on our Instagram. I think we actually have some from last week, from when I played this with Sammy and our brother and sister-in-law for the first time.
I took some good pictures.
Yeah, so we'll,
I posted one on Instagram.
We'll have some
already
stuff up. Yeah. Oh, nice job.
Because both of these games had elephants in them.
They do,
and I took pretty good pictures of the elephants.
Here's two completely completely superficial pros for each of these games. One for each. Rajas of the Ganges has the coolest first player marker ever.
It's true.
It's this little cute cardboard elephant. Meeple Circus.
Oh, there's a little dude riding it too.
Oh, that's right. There is.
And actually, the your meeples that you place in Rajas of the Ganges, that would have been a pro for me as well, because they're a little bit different, and I like the way they got their little feet.
They got a little cool feel.
Yeah.
Pro for Meeple Circus, and I still, every time I play this game with somebody who's seeing it for the first time, the insert is so spot on. There is a place and a function for every single cutout, for every single indent. The whole thing just fits together so perfectly when you put everything into the box. And the first time I didn't realize it, like I didn't appreciate it as I was unboxing it. But then when I got everything put back together and realized just how perfectly everything goes into place, I was just like, man, they really knocked it out of the park with this insert. And I know we don't talk about that often. Like, I know we didn't really talk about it with Lords of Waterdeep, which also has a really cool insert. But I love that attention to detail with games. So,
Kim, do you have any more pros in different area codes?
Well, that was the edited version of that song, wasn't it?
Yeah,
that was.
My favorite Ludacris song that played on the radio, though, was Saturday Ooh Ooh. You know what I'm talking about?
Mine was...
Got a big weed stash, pocket full of cash.
Just seen a big old...
Yeah.
Sticky, icky.
Mine was...
It was... Sleepy Brown's in that song, right?
I think so.
Roll Out's my jam.
Remember when he did the MTV Music Video Awards and he was on the street and he had all the cars? He's like, roll out. Bow, bow, bow. Bow, 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 bow.
I just like when he goes, what in the world is in that room? What you got in that room?
can we just talk about how bad rap has gotten? Because when Ludacris came out, he was kind of lame compared to like what else is going on, but he's actually really good.
Yeah, I was just talking about how good Ludacris is.
It's not gotten bad. It's gotten different. Like, there are still some cool rappers that are out there.
Tell me. So Ludacris is like huge, and he was like, I would say, like on the bottom end of talent of what was like big when he was doing it. And he's really talented, but like the really famous guys right now are like, who's that one dude like that like has a really obnoxious Lil Yachty?
Lil Yachty.
And hey, then, Josh.
And then there's that guy with the rainbow hair.
Hold on. 6'9"?
Yeah.
I have that's like the only thing that
Tekashi
I have.
6'9" or whatever his name is.
The 6'9" is like the only thing that I have like blacklisted on Twitter. I don't want to hear anything about that dude.
Yeah.
Dude's a pedophile.
Yeah. Sure is.
But
hey, back to Sleepy Brown though. Also in another great radio hit.
Back to cons of Meeple Circus.
I'm not good at it. Like I know at the end we all kind of tied it up, and this was your first time playing, so you kind of things go. Well, Frank got close to tying it up. There was a point spread of 3 between first and last place.
So
I put down 2 wins tonight, you guys.
Yeah, and you know, I just we'll get to that. What was I just about to say about that?
I don't know. What were you about to say about that?
Oh shoot!
I'm gonna say I shake a lot when I get nervous, and so I am naturally bad at a game like this. Like Sammy doesn't shake. We talked about this. She doesn't like shake a ton, but she said her hands get a little sweaty, and so like there's things that there are physical reactions. There are physical reactions that as a player you have to this game as you're playing it, and the reactions that my body has just make me not good at this game.
Definitely one of the first things I thought of as a con for this game was that it's not like very accessible, in that like someone who, you know, has some sort of
the jitters,
like or like a muscular dystrophy or something like that,
yeah,
like might not be as like, I mean, like the game is made in a way that it's like this is a game that's not for you, whereas there's games out there like Nyctophobia that are created for specifically for people who aren't, you know,
they have a disability.
And I thought of that right away as a, I mean, not every game is going to be for everybody.
Right.
Like, the Euro game isn't necessarily for a person who, like me, has trouble like thinking of a lot of different numbers and your next move all the time.
Yeah.
But like, you know, to me, that's kind of a bummer for a game to be created specifically that like some people who, yeah, like you can't help be the way that you're born, or like a disease that you get.
We're getting deep tonight's episode with our cons.
You guys
we're really digging in.
It was just
to keep it completely fluff.
No,
over
that
here.
That was just an immediate thought that I had about this game.
Yeah. So. No. I like I said, I think my immediate reaction is my physical reaction to this game when it starts to get super stressful does not lend itself well to this game because my steady hands get completely shot, but I also think that's part of it, right? Like if I was just super calm and collected and didn't flinch at all as I was playing pieces, this game probably wouldn't be as fun, right?
Depends who you ask.
Yeah, fair. Other than that though, like I mean for what this game is, I think this game really is firing on all cylinders. There, like the dexterity thing is just something that, and there are people out there that just don't like dexterity games. They like for whatever reason, that's fine. But I can't really think of another. Oh, that's not true. I do have one. There are community objective cards that you're playing against.
This is my other con. We got the same cons.
Yeah, there are community objective cards.
I think I was going to talk about it too, actually.
You go first. You go. No, we've talked. So you go.
So I think a perceived con of this game could be that the community objective cards don't always line up well with what you're drafting.
Exactly.
And I think that a possible con of the game is that you have to put on your Euro hat when drafting if you're going later down the line, and you have to think of, if I can't get the points the obvious way, how do I get the points the not obvious way? I think the components in the game exist. I think the components that do exist could always lead to victory for you. You just have to do things outside of the realm of what's easy to do for points. So I could see people being frustrated when they don't get the pieces they want for the stuff they want to accomplish.
Yeah.
So the situationally, though, you always have access to like the red meeples that can get you a lot of points.
Yep.
You always have access to 4 different objectives, and you can always get the components to do at least one of them.
Yep.
The thing that could be frustrating for people is you might get forced into stuff that requires more dexterous skill to do, like stacking a red guy really high in order to compete with the fact that somebody just got drafted the things that are going to let them get 4 points twice.
Right.
And I'm going to disagree slightly in that 2 of our public objectives required
elephants.
The purple barrel and the beam that we couldn't didn't have access to in the first round of drafting.
Right.
And then only one card in the first round gave anyone access to an elephant. And then I got horses thinking, oh, there's a good possibility that in the next couple of rounds, like a horse objective will come up.
Yep.
And it never did. So Cam was the only person that had access to an elephant in the first couple of rounds.
Josh had an elephant, but let me ping pong paddle this back at you. There was access to planks and barrels in the first round, and that was by far the easiest point thing to get. But I never actually utilized the elephant for points in the first two rounds. I used
you
him both
vertical
times
to get your
to
red
turn
guy
him vertical
higher.
To get my red guy up.
Yeah, I completely see the point that you're making, though, and I agree. I think I would like to see, and it might just be a simple house rule.
Yeah, I chose last, and I didn't have access to an elephant in the first couple of rounds, mm-hmm. and all of the public. And I looked at the options there, and I thought these are the best options for what I
yep.
for what I can do.
Yep.
I know that I'm going to get the least amount of points because of this.
Yep.
And so that means that I can flip this elephant card and hopefully get a horse one.
Yeah.
And there was another elephant one and no opportunity for me to get an elephant.
At the very end, I was like, I'm going to feel bad if I told you, because I think I said there's four different piles of cards, and they normally have objectives around certain things. And I was terrified that I gave you the wrong color card to discard from. And then I looked, and it was literally right after the last card that we pulled up, because we got three elephant cards in a row.
There were like
the
four
rest
horse
of the game,
cards.
They were all horse cards. And so that's just...
It was just a bad deal. I mean, I'm not a big fan of the randomness. There's not a lot of randomness that's because of the randomness of those stacks, and then also of what you are drafting between.
Yeah.
There's generally, I think probably in most plays of this, not that big of a discrepancy in those issues.
Yeah.
It was still a close game. We ended the game close.
Well, yeah. I mean, so here's truly the con of the game is that you do have to think to score high for a party game, because I don't think I did a better job balancing than any of you guys. In fact, I crashed my last tower.
Yeah.
But I utilized, like, I think Euro stuff to like try to, how can I Melvin the most points out of just simple towers?
Sure. I will say for, and I don't know if this isn't necessarily an asterisk, but I lost you by 1 point and I finished with time to spare. And then right when I got done, this was user error. I
realized
looked down and
had
I had a barrel that was hiding behind, or not hiding, but it was placed behind the pile that I was building from. So from my sight line, I couldn't see it. And had I had that and gotten my red guy up just a little higher, we would have tied. And in this game, ties are shared.
If I hadn't knocked my whole tower over with 5 seconds left to build, I would have won by like 10 points.
That's different, though. That's you going for greatness, which I appreciate, versus me just having a piece hidden from my view that I didn't realize until after I had deconstructed my tower.
And end of the day,
end of the day,
you didn't see the barrel. End of the day, his tower fell over. The points were scored how they were.
I gotta say, these were really close games tonight.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Except for Rogers of the Ganges, where I just wasn't even close to even scoring.
Yeah, it was your first time.
Who do we think this game is for? I think that if you enjoy dexterity games and if you enjoy party games, definitely consider picking this one up. And I'll say that for two reasons. I have played this game 4 times over the course of the last week with multiple different game groups, and I haven't played with a single person yet that did not have a good time. There may have been somebody that was trying to like figure out how the game works in the first round, but we played it, and this game plays fast enough that if you have a bad game, you reset and you play again. And here's the biggest reason that I like this game. Tonight, before I came over to record, for the first time in a very long time, Sammy turned to me and she forgot that we were recording, and she said, "Would you like to play Meeple Circus tonight?" And that is
nice.
The first time in a year that Sammy has proactively requested that we play a board game. And to me, that means that there's something here, and knowing that I would consider, I'm not like an elitist or a snob, but I play way more board games than Sammy does, and I love this game, and she's much more casual, and she gets excited enough about this game to ask me to play. So I'm going to just throw it out there that if you enjoy dexterity games or if you just like family games, this is a must own. There, I mean, it's just, it's so fun. The themes there, the sensory additions are great. It's just, I love it. I really do.
I'm tempted to get this game myself just because I feel like I could play it with just about anybody.
Yeah.
So that's...
Yeah. If I think about, so my family likes games, but a lot of people in my, like, my family, my brothers like kind of crunchy, nerdier stuff, and a couple of my sisters-in-law. But when I think, if I could get my dad to play this game, who like hates to learn new stuff.
Yep.
It's a great family. And I think I could get my dad to play this game.
Yeah. I mean,
I think he would like it.
There are a couple games in the last year. So I always, when I buy family games, I always put it through the lens of, would I be able to get my family to play this on the 4th of July? Cause there's a ton of different, opinions there and a ton of different styles of gamers. And there's two games that have come out this year or that I've picked up this year, three games that I think, regardless of the person, they would have a good time playing. Would you guys like to guess at what the other two games are?
Yes.
What
the
do you
other
think
two
the
family games?
The other two games that I am very excited to own because I know they will
the
go
climbers.
Over well. No. Not a bad guess, though.
How many people are you playing with?
Between 3 and 6.
Karuba.
No.
Oh, man.
We've played one
probably,
of them together.
Probably sure. Azul or Sagrada.
Neither.
Oh, really?
Man, you guys are whiffing hard. I'm just going to tell you.
No, come on.
We've played it. We've played it together.
I feel like
on
I...
the cast?
Not on the cast.
No.
But we played it here.
Oh, that
the
one
mine?
With the cards. That one was...
Yeah. Nessus?
Yeah, Nessus.
Love that game. Mm-hmm. Or Nessus.
Yeah.
Love that game.
You mentioned how much you liked that one.
Super fun card game. Still love to play that whenever I can. And Nyctophobia is the other game that I think, regardless of... And that's just because that game, as we've said, even if you don't like the game... It's still such a cool experience, or like a different experience the first time that you play it.
I haven't played yet. We really got to do that.
That I really want to. I want to have my larger family.
Have you played that yet, Frank?
I haven't.
No. We'll play it. Yeah, we'll play it sometime.
Yeah,
just for
it.
Fun. Anyway, anything else that you guys want to add about either game? I'm curious, Frank, from your standpoint, knowing that you sometimes go for games that are I don't want to say lighter, but those are the games that are a little bit more in your wheelhouse. Which did you prefer between the two tonight?
I liked Meeple Circus better.
Okay.
I mean, I like a lot of stuff about Rogers of the Ganges, and I will play it again. But I'm much more like, if you put the two in front of me and said, which one do you want to play again right now? I would say Meeple Circus.
Campbell, same question, but I know you skew a little on the heavier
side.
No.
I am just as excited to play either of these games, seriously. And the group, obviously I would pick Meeple Circus probably more often depending on the group.
Yep.
But I think that people I would play Rogers of the Ganges with would also enjoy this game.
Yeah.
Like some of my friends who enjoy... crunchy stuff probably don't like it so much.
Yeah.
I don't remember how Jared felt about this game. If you guys remember Jared from the group.
Jared
is one of my friends who knows what he likes, and he really likes what he really likes, and he really doesn't like what he really doesn't like. But I think even he might have had a little fun playing this game. I don't think he'd ask for it again.
A thing I want to say about who this game is, who Meeple Circus is for, mm-hmm. that I just kind of was thinking of, I'm looking at the box, and it looks on the surface like a game that like you might play with like a 5-year-old. But the box says 8+, and I can definitely see why. Like as far as the actual mechanics of the game, you wouldn't want to play with someone younger than that. But I think that a kid eight plus would really enjoy this game.
If you are playing, I'm going to make a fairly. I feel like this is a very safe statement. If you have a child that you play games with that is older than 8 years old. And the only reason I would caution even younger than that is just because, one, I'm not going to let Evelyn come anywhere close to this game for at least 2 years because I'm worried she'll choke on one of the small meeples accidentally. But if you are a big fan of Rhino Hero, I feel like this is a very safe game in that same vein that I would strongly suggest you check out. That, I feel...
This game is way crunchier than Rhino Hero.
Yeah, but I'm saying if you like that game, I feel like this is a nice next step from that. But let's keep it moving. We're well past an hour, and we still got some beautiful, beautiful plugs to get to, or beefs. So, Campbell, I'm going to start with you.
There's a fork in the road, and you can't tell which way it goes. Plug or beef?
It's beef or plug.
Oh, okay.
Welcome to beef or plug.
Is it beef or plug?
Yeah.
Welcome to beef or plug.
Beef or plug.
It's your boys, the Bored Boys Podcast, coming to you hot with another dose of Before Plug.
That was a daily double sound.
That's Shock Jock Radio. Franklin, we're going to start with you this evening. Who do you have for your beef or plug? Or what do you have? Or where do you have for your beef or plug?
Oh, I think this week my beef or plug is going to be kind of a gimme. Jamie Stegmaier.
Oh, that's a huge plug. Huge plug.
I'm going to go with maybe out of line here, but I'm going to say plug.
It's definitely a plug. We had Jamie on the bonus episode that y'all hopefully listened to last week. It was a very, very fun experience for us, and we got a lot out of it. I think Jamie got a lot out of it too. Obviously, we're pretty influential.
Yeah.
So
he actually said he's gonna name his next board game the Board Boys Trace.
Heck yeah!
What's it about?
I don't know. We have to wait and see.
So yeah, it was really cool having him on, and I am super appreciative for him for doing it.
Heck yeah. Jamie's awesome. Campbell, you're up next.
Oh, I gotta go next.
Who do you got? Kay. Oh, you don't get to. You're it's your turn. You're up.
Okay.
Wait, yeah, so you do get to. Never mind. I retract that statement.
I didn't even say anything. That's
just
your
go.
Gift for
just
that's
go.
Your birthday gift. Rob Pearson.
Beef.
You guys are both wrong. It's a plug. Rob has been going like triple time these last couple weeks. He's been out there working out super hard.
Oh yeah.
And
I've been liking all of his posts, Elite Edge Ankeny posts on Facebook.
He's looking swole.
I believe it.
So get out there, get it, Rob. I miss playing board games with you because we've both had kind of opposite schedules lately, but you're the man.
Yeah, last time I saw you, we said we were going to play War of the Ring. So let's do that. Hit me up. Josh, who's your beef or plug?
I'm going to say the entire backfield for the Jacksonville Jaguars.
That's a beef.
Yeah, sounds like a beef.
Oh, it's a hard beef.
And let me see, I'm 2 for 2 today.
Let me tell you why. So as you guys know, I am obsessed this time of year with fantasy football. I'm first place in one of my leagues. I'm 8th place in my other league. And tonight we're going to talk about the league that I'm in 8th place. I drafted Leonard Fournette 8th overall in the draft. That's not true. I had the 11th pick. So I drafted Leonard Fournette 11th overall in this year's draft, starting running back for the Jacksonville Jaguars. Sorry, I had a brain fart there. Long story short, he gets a hamstring injury in the first game in the second quarter. So he leaves. TJ Yeldon, his backup, gets put in. I don't have TJ Yeldon. So I pick him up during week 2. Fournette's out. Yeldon's going to play. So I put Yeldon in. He does fine. Week 3, Yeldon's going to get the start. I put Yeldon in. Yeldon does fine. Week 4, Fournette's back. His hamstring's good. So I start Fournette because I've got him on my bench, right? Dude plays 1 quarter of football, repeats the same injury, and is back to the bench. And in fantasy football, you can't swap players just because they get taken out of the game, even if you have their backup on your bench. So that cost me a ton of points, which cost me that victory.
There's like a percentage or like possibility of them, like how prone they are to injury, like in most apps, right?
And they gave them like questionable tags.
Yeah,
so they'll say like, hey, this guy, but this guy.
So
like,
you have to make a decision. Like, is this person gonna?
Yeah, I mean, mid-season for running back number one and running back number two positions. I mean, everyone is gonna be like, oh, so and so didn't practice on Wednesday because they have an ankle injury. Like, it's that time. We're getting to that time of the year. So it's always safe to assume that your guy that you're gonna roll with is probably gonna have an injury designation the first couple days of the week, and he'll get light practice. That's a whole nother thing. Anyway,
you know that I play Final Fantasy fantasy football.
No, you don't.
Let me guess.
Go ahead.
So so you put your other guy back in. He does fine for a couple of games.
Yeah.
And then the other guy is brought back, supposed to be good. And you go, oh, you know what? He's gonna get injured again, so I'm not gonna put him back in. And then he goes in and rips it and does an awesome job.
Not quite. I'm so heated because I now have Leonard Fournette and TJ Yeldon, who is supposed to be the starting running back and his backup. Right now the backup is playing because the starting running back is out, right? TJ Yeldon is projected to start this week. I've got him in my starting spot. I'll be fine. They have a bye next week. What did they do today? They went out and traded for Carlos Hyde, who's the starting running back for the Cleveland Browns, to now take over the backup role responsibilities, which means if Leonard Fournette doesn't come back after his bye week, which he's projected to, but we'll see.
You won't and have a even running
if
back
he gets,
playing.
Even if he gets injured again,
you won't have a running back
I won't have a
plays.
Running back because they're going to go with Carlos Hyde.
Oh, man.
So yeah. I've effectively been dicked over by the Jacksonville Jaguars backfield. So what
You've
I'm saying.
You've effectively been dinked over.
I've been dinked over. I'm trying for some trades right now to just get rid of it so I don't have to deal with the whole situation. It's a whole thing. But Jacksonville Jaguars, Leonard Fournette, I really hope you get better. It sucks that your hamstring is acting up, and I would never wish ill will towards you. But if you could come back and then not get hurt the rest of the season, I would really appreciate it.
This is what I have to say to you, Fournette. Walk it off, you wuss.
Hey, can I just tell you guys what Final Fantasy Fantasy Football is really quick?
Sure.
Oh, we were already so... that's all the time we
have. No. It's when you and two other friends draft the players on the player team and the computer team in that underwater football game they play in Final Fantasy X.
Yeah.
And then somebody Blitzball. Who's not part of the league plays, and then you score points based on how well each of the players does.
Hey, I've got another beef or plug.
Go ahead. Let's wrap this up. What do you got?
1,003 people.
Oh, that's a plug.
That sounds like a plug to me.
Yeah, so that's a plug for our 1,003 people who have liked us on Facebook.
Yeah, we broke 1,000.
We broke 1,000.
I'm the most recent one.
Yeah. Campbell finally learned how to use social media and liked his own podcast on social media.
I thought I liked it a year later. Day one, yeah.
So,
I thought I was down from day one.
I know we say this a lot, but thank you guys so much for checking us out.
Where else can they check us out?
You can also check us out on Twitter, Instagram, etc. You can email us at theboardboyspodcast@gmail.com.
Yep.
The Board Boys Podcast on Instagram and the Board Boys Pod on Twitter.
Yep.
Y'all know where to listen to us because you are doing that currently.
We're on your favorite streaming platforms that you're likely listening to now, but if you want to shake things up, we're on iTunes, Stitcher, SoundCloud, Spotify, and Google Play Music.
Make sure you let a friend know about us. We like chatting with you. We like letting you know what's up in our brains about board games. And we'd love to talk to your friends, too. All right. So thanks, everyone, for listening. And enjoy your spooky season. Have fun. Have a nice Halloween next week.
Until next time, we hope you like
board games.
What will happen in the morning when the weather gets so crowded that you can't look out the window in the morning? What will happen in the evening in the forest with a weasel with the teeth that bite so sharp when you're not looking in the evening? And all the friends that you once knew and left behind, they kept you safe and so secure amongst the books and all the records of your lifetime. What will happen in the morning when the world gets so crowded that you can't look out the window in the morning? Take a little while to make your sister fat. And now that the family is part of a chain, take off your high shade, start over.